Good morning and welcome to Bay Area Presbyterian Church. We are glad you're here with us this morning as we gather to worship the Lord. We've got quite a bit in store for us this morning, not only in our worship, but also in wanting to introduce to you all some of our seniors that are graduating. Going to bring them up in just a moment. A couple brief announcements. Let me get through some of the just the particulars. If you'll see on the back of your bulletin. That's right. Thank you. The BBS, this has always been a big thing for us, June 12th to the 16th. That's a typo. Mine's a typo. But Tracy fixed it before I got mine. So, thank you. July 16th, 12th to the 16th, looking for participants, volunteers, as always. This is a great time for us to reach out to our communities, allowing them to come and bring their families and their children to hear the gospel. Secondly, Women's Night Out, June 18th. Please make yourself aware of that, ladies, gathering together at the home of Amy Antill. And then lost and found items, we'll let you work through those. There have been two Bibles that have been in that box for many, many months. I know your names. You don't need to be ashamed. Come claim your Bibles. So we all do it. No worries. And then the rest there is Facebook and online giving that you're well aware of. So we have the distinct pleasure of having some of our young people making moves, two of them graduating, and I'd like to ask them to come forward if they would, please. Emma Lewis and Avery Antill. I need a hot mic. This is Paul's. May I just turn this on for them to speak into? Check one, two, three. Check one, two, three. Great. These two of both young ladies that have grown up in this church from wee years ago, they have both graduated or graduating. Graduating, has it happened? Not yet. Wednesday and Saturday. Very good. They have both passed. They have both done extraordinarily well in their academics, as well as maintaining a high GPA, as well as making life work as a senior in high school, which we all remember quite well. We're eminently proud of them. I'm going to ask them just to tell us where they're going and what they're going to be studying. Emma, tell us why you're leaving this great state of Texas.
I'm going to University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I will be studying biochemistry.
Wait. And why are you leaving the great state of Texas? Emma is going to be following her mom. Of course, Tracy is going to be moving back to Wisconsin as well. That's not why she mainly wanted to go back. She wanted to go to an excellent university that she's always had her heart set on and worked for all these years. And Tracy will be transitioning about mid-August to the late August. And you will be following her, with her, close by. Yeah, good. And then tell us why you're leaning towards biology.
I want to do pre-med, so I'll be doing biochemistry and then going on to medical school afterwards.
Excellent. There are very good medical schools in the state of Texas. I'm sorry. Why don't you pass the microphone to Avery? Let me pick on her for a minute. Avery, tell us where you're going and what you're going to be studying.
I'm going to Indiana University, and I'll be studying Arabic and international relations.
Okay, could you say the second part of that again for us, please? You're going to be studying
Arabic and international relations.
Wonderful.
Biblical studies.
Excellent. Can you tell us what drew you to that?
I met somebody who worked a lot in international relations and basically communication in the media, and he was a really, really interesting person, and I was kind of inspired by him to help the world communicate a little better.
Great. And this is an unfair question, but we're going to ask it. So can you tell us, wave the wand, you get out of 4 years of school, the world is your oyster, what would you love to be doing?
With not college or anything?
You're finished college. You just finished 4 years of college, you got your degree, and you're going out to do something. What do you want to do?
I want to work in probably international diplomacy overseas.
Great. Yeah. We are eminently proud of our students, and particularly these two young ladies. We're going to do a traditional thing here. We're going to give them two books. That's just what they want to do at the end of their senior year is read another book. So let me tell you why we're giving these books and we're giving them purposefully. This book is called Surviving Religion 101. This is written by Dr. Michael Kruger. Dr. Kruger went to the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, one of the most liberal campuses in our nation, but an excellent academic school. After he got through there, he went and pursued and was called to the ministry, spent 4 years at Reformed Theological Seminary, went over and got a degree, a PhD at the University of Edinburgh. He's a sharp cookie. He is president of Reformed Theological Seminary in Charlotte, North Carolina. He writes particularly about New Testament canon as well as inspiration and the authority of Scripture. He has written a number of chapters to his daughter about issues such as, what about my faith in science? What about the veracity of the New Testament documents? What about Christian morals? What about sexual identity? What about the universe? What about miracles? How can I really know God? What about my professor who says the Gospels contradict one another, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? These are things that they will be facing when you go to the secular university. You need to know what you believe and why you believe it. So we thought this would be handy, something they can grab, as well as Tim Keller, along with his wife, has written a weekly, daily devotional on the Book of Proverbs, wisdom, and it also has a ready access in the front where you can look up things, everything from friendship, words, gossip, guidance, marriage, sex, parenting, money, power, justice, in that order. Fear of the Lord, understanding the heart, wisdom, foolishness, how to be like Jesus. So we give these to you, a very, very small token. Please don't be offended. This is our way of saying we love you. We go with you. We want to be your second or third phone call should you need anything. Maybe your third or fourth, but put us on speed dial. We love you. We are eminently proud of what you've accomplished, and we can't wait to see what the Lord has in store for both of you. Great job. Great job. I can let you go and not pray for you. Pray with us. Father, we thank you for your sustaining grace over these years that you have brought Emma and Avery to this place where they have done it, and you have given them gifts and graces. They have used them. They have worked hard, and you have rewarded their hard work. We thank you, and we pray that you would go with them, be their vanguard and their rear guard. Go with them, protect them, guide, direct them in these times. They long to learn more about you and your world, and they will be tempted, they will be drawn, they will be challenged. We pray that you would be with them every step of the way, and that you would never let them forget that you are the Lord our God, the one who protects us, goes with us, and holds us in the very palm of your hand. Encourage them where they get scared, give them great courage, confidence. Where they get overwhelmed, would you give them strength to take one day, one step at a time? And would you help them to keep their eye on the prize that you have given to them, a vision for what you're calling them to do to the honor and glory of Christ? Do that great work, and we will praise you for it. And we give them to you and ask you for your protection in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. Well, let's keep this ball rolling. Where's Paul? Paul Kindervater? Paul, where are you? Come up here, son. Most of you know Paul Kindervater. Paul is the proud son of Fred and Rachel. Paul, how long are you at school here? How long have you been at Texas State?
2 years.
2 years. Paul is going to work in the great state of Iowa.
Ohio.
Midwest. You do want to come back to Texas, don't you?
Depends on how Ohio is.
Yeah, all right. Okay. Tell us what you're going to do for the summer. Let's make it brief. Come, these girls did it. You can do it.
All right. I'm going to Ohio to play with Athletes of Action. It's a baseball organization within the Gospel of the Word. You can say kind of like a missionary.
Absolutely.
We give back to Ohio communities within a 60-game schedule. So we play 6 games a week, and after the games, we get back to the communities that we travel to. With COVID, it's a little bit different because we're supposed to go to Canada, Australia and with all those places, but since of COVID, we're just gonna stay in Ohio. The cities are Great Lakes, and I think close kind of north of New York. So wherever we travel, we're trying to spread the word of the Lord. Not just within baseball and the game of that baseball, but we're gonna use the game of the Lord, the game that the Lord made to spread the word to others, other teammates, other opponents, and of course the cities. So that's our goal, our mission post, you can say, for this summer. And then wherever I go from there is, where I go.
Like, the Lord knows.
Yep.
Tell it. Give us a couple things to pray for as you go. We'll cover safety.
Yeah.
What else?
Safety on the bus rides and, of course, my teammates. Composure for me and 60-game schedule is going to be hard on me mentally and physically.
Sure.
My body. I just got out of rehab. I had a slap tear in my shoulder. I kind of lost a lot of velo and the skill level that the Lord gave me, so I'm trying to earn it back. So that would be very appreciated if I could get my strength back from him. I guess love with the team, because it's like brotherhood, even though I don't know the guy. It's just you're 60 games with him, and it's like a little brother. You're going to drive each other nuts. So if love with each other would be great. And, of course, hopefully to be able to spread the word and actually people listening and take it in. And let the Lord do his work.
Great. I'm going to ask, I need 20 people who would raise their hand and commit to pray for Paul for this summer. 20 people. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, we're over. We're going with you. We want to be your third phone call. Actually, call your dad, call your mom, and then call me.
You don't pick up the phone sometimes.
Well, I'm a busy guy, you know. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for Paul's life. We thank you that this covenant child who grew up in this church and went to our school has gone on now to college and used the gifts and abilities that you've given him in athletics, especially in baseball. We pray not only for his safety as he travels, we pray that you would grow him spiritually, that you would grow him emotionally, that you would grow him more and more into the image of Christ. You would strengthen his shoulder. You would bring healing to that, that that would not be a hindrance to him, and that he would be able to use his gifts to your honor and glory. We pray for those relationships that form and that we stressed. We can't choose our family, and sometimes we can't choose our ball team. So I pray that you would give him extraordinary grace to be patient, forbearing, and that you give him a blast, Father. Use him in this ministry to continue to spread your word and the good gospel to the athletics and the abilities and the games that you have graced us with and given him the gifts to play and oh, play so well. Watch over him, we pray. Bring him back safely to us, and we give him to you in Christ's name. Amen. Mm-hmm. Not breaking up. Why don't you stand with me? Let's hear the word of the Lord as he calls us to worship him. Coming from the book of Revelation, chapter 5, we see this gathering throng of God's people, angels gathering together to worship him. Respond with me. And they sang a new song, saying, then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice, they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise."
Holy, holy, holy,
pray with me. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we gather this day to sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." We come longing to know that you're in our midst and that you will meet us here as we gather as your people. Pour out your Spirit upon us. Draw us near to you. Reaffirm us, reassure us that the gospel is true, that we stand before a holy God, drenched in the blood of Christ with the robe of his righteousness, that we are your children forever, and that you might lift our chins, lift our hearts, straighten our shoulders, increase our confidence that Jesus reigns, that he loves us, and that he longs and loves to hear our praise. Do that good work in us, and we will thank you for it. In Christ's name, amen.
You are holy, you are mighty.
With such power, we reaffirm our faith as God's people, the church. Christian, what is the church of Jesus Christ? The church of Jesus Christ is a gathering of forgiven sinners, called to be holy, dedicated to service, saved by the patient grace of God. We deal patiently with others. Knowing our own weaknesses and failures, we bring good news to all sinners with understanding of their condition and with hope in God. We grieve that the church, which shares one spirit, one faith, one hope, and spans all time, place, race, and language, has become a broken communion in a broken world. When we struggle for the purity of the church and for the righteousness God demands, we pray for saintly courage. When our pride or blindness blocks the unity of God's household, we seek forgiveness. We marvel that the Lord gathers the broken pieces to do his work, and that he blesses us still with joy, new members, and surprising evidences of unity. And we commit ourselves to seeking and expressing the oneness of all who follow Jesus Christ.
Come and behold it, the one.
Would you please be seated?
In Romans chapter 12, Paul exhorts us to be transformed by the renewal of our minds. And one of the ways we do that is through the truth of Scripture. So with that in mind, let me read to us today's call for renewal. And it comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. And in those verses, Jesus says, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." We're only able to fulfill this command of Jesus because God first loved us and gave his Son as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And that sacrifice atoned for our sins particularly. So as we move into a time of confession, I want us to reflect upon the particularity of the atonement and the particularity of our confession. And to do that, I want to read a portion of the Westminster Confession of Faith, namely chapter 15, section 5, which says, "Men ought not to content themselves with a general repentance, but it is every man's duty to endeavor to repent of his particular sins particularly." So today's corporate confession is a little bit different than the normal format. It is a responsive reading. And following the corporate confession, we'll move directly into a private confession. So respond with me. "Most merciful Father, we have sinned against you and are guilty before you. Forgive us the sins of our tongues. Forgive us the sins of our eyes,
for impurity in our senses and imaginations, for pining after world beauty, comfort, status, and wealth that you have given us.
Forgive us the sins of our hearts, for hard-heartedness towards you and our neighbors, for pride, self-absorption, and self-pity, and above all, for rebelling against your lordship and doubting your love. Forgive us, we pray, most merciful Father, and free us from our sin. Renew us in the grace and strength of your Holy Spirit, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen." Triune God, we praise you for your eternal plan of redemption. Lord Jesus Christ, we praise you for dying for our sins and giving us eternal life. Father, receive our confession, mortify our sins, and sanctify us by the power of your Holy Spirit. Renew us each day to become more like the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray these things in his name. Amen. So today's words of encouragement come from Psalm 130, verses 3 and 4. And the psalmist says, "If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you. And one of the ways we serve God is by giving back a portion of what He has given us through our tithes and offerings. And I want to remind everyone of the opportunity to give online or through the boxes in the lobby. And we remain grateful for your ongoing support. And at this time, I invite the choir to come and sing to us.
As we go before the Lord together, would you bow with me before the throne of grace as we seek God's help in our time of need? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of prayer. We have already confessed our sins And you know how silent we have been this past week when we should have come running to your throne of grace to find that mercy and grace that we so desperately need. We thank you that you invite us to come because we come in the name of Christ, and therefore we come with great confidence, not on our own, but because of him and all he has done for us and continues to do. You urge us strongly to entreat and pray with petitions and thanksgiving on behalf of all people in the world, and our hearts continue to be broken for the Middle East. How far we have gone from you that we would do the things that we do to one another, Lord, in our nation and against other nations and other nations against other nations and countries. Our prayer is simple this day. It's simple but impossible for us to do, but you can. We pray that you would be pleased in the name of Christ in the Middle East to command the angel of death to sheath his sword, and you would release the word of God through Christians in those countries and missionaries there, that the word of God and the gospel would run free, that they would know of the gospel of peace, which would lead them to the Prince of Peace and enable them to live at peace with you and with each other. Please stop the killing. Work in the leaders. Do what only you can do to restore what we cannot restore. Do that great work, and we pray that you would do it now, if it be pleasing and according to your will. We pray also for our own leaders here at home and ask that you would continue at all levels of our government to guide and direct the decision-making of all the branches, local as well as federal. Pray that you would remind those that lead and guide us that they are accountable to you, that you are the Lord, that you have placed them where they are. It is not by happenstance, it is not by good fortune, but by the hand of Almighty God that they are placed where they are. Help them to feel that weight, and enable them and cause them to seek you for your wisdom, because we need wise leaders to lead us in our nation. Do that good work, we pray, as well. We pray that you would be pleased to do that so that we could continue to enjoy a quiet life in all godliness and dignity. We pray for the missionaries around the world. We pray for the Gahagans in particularly. Father, they continue to do work in Peru, and we thank you for the way that you have raised up churches, one of which you've allowed us to participate in as a church to get their plane back into good shape and back in the air, continuing to do their work as they spread the gospel of the grace of God into deep parts of Peru that we aren't even aware of. We pray you would bless them, keep them, you would encourage them this day, and all the missionaries, all those who have left home, family, comforts, peace, and that you would remind them and encourage them in ways that only you by your Spirit can. Their labors are never in vain. You are at work in their lives, and you are at work in their ministries. And we pray that you would bless them and encourage them with that. We pray that you would continue to pour out your Spirit upon our nation. We need to be renewed and revived, and we need you to draw us near to you. And we pray that you would be pleased to continue to work even in our local churches here in the Clear Lake area, this very day, this very morn, where the gospel is heralded, your word is preached and taught, the gospel of Christ is celebrated, the word of God is preached with great power and with great encouragement. Encourage us in the greater Clear Lake area, in Houston, Father, that you would be using your churches, your very bride, as ugly as we are, to continue to move forth the kingdom of grace and to push back and destroy the kingdom of darkness in our own hearts, in our own churches, in our own town, in our great city. We pray that you would be pleased to continue to visit us with great waves of sanctifying grace in our own church. We long to be more like our Savior. And we pray that you would be pleased to pour out your Spirit upon us, Father. As we move into this next phase of life, as we look, as the pandemic continues to lessen, and that we begin to be restored back to whatever normal is going to look like, we want to tell you and confess to you ahead of time that we know that our trying times within the church are not going to be over. Matter of fact, they're probably going to be multiplied. We pray for your reconciling grace to be abundantly poured out on us every day and every Sunday morning, that we would learn to love and care for each other in ways that we never knew we were able nor desired. Do that great work. We love and long to be innerly tied together more closely, even as you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, enjoy great community within the Holy Trinity. And Father, finally, we pray for those that are in our midst that continue to struggle. Sickness, affliction, the physical, spiritual, psychological, emotional. Father, we are a broken people. We thank you that we are redeemed. We thank you for the forgiveness of Christ. But we long for those healing times that will take our attention off of our pain and distress and worry and be fixated back upon the Holy One, who we now through Christ are able to call Abba Father. Give us what we need, and then give us the grace to accept what you have for us. Strengthen and encourage our faith. Take our hearts and our minds off of everything of this world that would so gather and preoccupy our minds. We long to worship you clearly and only, because we know that is our place of healing and that is our place of peace. So we open your word. We pray that you would come by your Spirit and teach us. We long to know more of your word and more what you have for us as we follow our resurrected and ascended Lord. Teach us now, we pray. Encourage us, and we commit it all to you in the matchless name of your Son and our Savior, our risen Lord Jesus. Amen. We have been looking since Easter at some what we call post-resurrection appearances of Christ. Thank you, David. But first of all, we would like to dismiss our children ages 4 years old to second grade to go to children's church. And we would like to take a special opportunity to thank this day all of the parents and all of the older people that teach our children. Thank you for your love for them and doing a great labor of love and work of grace in their lives as well. If I forget that next week, I need to be punished. David, you have permission to punish me next week. You got that? I'm sure you do. Thank you very much. Ugh. I can't even remember the names of my own kids. Give me a break, would you? So today we're going to look at the last passage, and it's probably the most well-known one, I think, of Jesus appearing to his disciples after he rose. It's in Acts chapter 1. And this, of course, is Jesus coming back. He has been with them 40 days after his resurrection. He has been teaching them, encouraging them, challenging them. And today, the question before them is going to be something like this. Our shorter catechism teaches that Jesus holds what we call three offices, that he has fulfilled the office of a prophet. He's the Word of God, and he teaches us his word. Prophet, priest, he intercedes for us. He died, the only sacrifice for us. And then king, that he has risen, conquered the grave, rules and reigns at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. The question that's before the disciples is something like this. So Jesus was our great priest. He told us he was going to die upon that cross for our sins, that he was going to rise, that he was going to ascend and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Now what? Right? What's next? Well, we just sit around and... No. He's a God of mission. And he is now going to commission his disciples as well as us. Stand with me and let's read this part of God's word together as we honor God's word. Jesus has paid the ultimate sacrifice. He has reconciled us to the Father. He has satisfied divine justice. Verse 3. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And after he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." This is God's word. Would you please be seated? Christian author Gabe Lyons wrote a book a few years ago called The Next Christians: 7 Ways You Can Live the Gospel and Restore the World. In it, he says this: "I was 27 years old, and I was embarrassed to be a Christian. This was especially odd because I was raised in a Christian home. I graduated from a Christian college. I served as vice president of a prominent Christian organization. By all accounts, I should have been one of Christianity's biggest fans. Unfortunately, I began to notice that the perceptions my friends and neighbors had about Christians were incredibly negative. They thought about Christians, and when they spoke of them, they spoke about them being judgmental, hypocritical, homophobic, too political, prideful killjoys who took every occasion to turn it into a chance to promote their own religious agenda. In fact, the past experiences of my friends has caused them to run from anything away from labeled Christian. And ironically, I have come to empathize with them. Having grown up in a Christian bubble myself, I witnessed countless instances when the lives of Christ's followers were incongruent with Jesus' call to be loving, sacrificial, unselfish, and compassionate." Those are hard words. Those are very hard words. And they're very hard for us as a church, at least for one reason. It's because these things fall upon generational lines. Those of you that are older, that grew up in what occurred to be a Christian majority in our culture years ago, are now looking at the culture now going, "We are going to hell in a handbasket, and it's time to get back to the good old days." Those of you that are of a younger generation, you grew up in a culture that you were a Christian minority, pluralistic secular culture, and your view of Jesus, your view of Christ, culture, and the way forward is almost diametrically opposed to anything that older generations now see. So why do we mention this? Because we are about to go into a new year. And if all those that are prognosticating and forecasting, this is the year we're headed towards. Those in the financial world are saying, we are probably headed towards a financial boom that we have not experienced in decades in this country and possibly in the world. There are those of us that have benefited greatly from the coronavirus. There are some of us that have not benefited at all. And there are some of us that have had our lives decimated and our jobs decimated due to this. How will we get on mission with Jesus if there is so much diversity of viewing ourselves, our nation, our culture, and our world? Why we go through that time of trying to figure out how to get back and get whole and healthy, not only as a congregation, but as families. Gabe Lyons tells us, he was offered a rare invitation to go up to Montreat College and sit on the back porch with the Reverend Billy Graham, a titan in past history of the Christian church. This is what he said: "I carefully explained to Mr. Graham that my organization's mission," he had started a Christian organization to try and help pastors and Christian leaders to understand the culture more clearly. "My organization's mission is to expose and to explain the culture to church leaders, to bring changes to our world, and more importantly, the opportunities that lay ahead through different kinds of ministries that we're used to." Listen. Mr. Graham seemed generally curious of how young leaders, from arts to education, medicine, were leveraging and bringing their talents for to witness for Christ and creating microfinance banks to loan money to the poor, building wells for people who do not have clear water, for developing marketing strategies and campaigns to increase awareness of adoption, all for the sake of honoring the work and the word of Jesus Christ. As I explained to Dr. Graham, I began to see a smile walk to the two sides of the 89-year-old's face. Billy Graham said to me, "Back when we did those big crusades, the Holy Spirit was really moving, and people were coming to Christ as we preached his word. But today I see evidence that the Spirit is working in a new way. He is moving through people at work and through relationships to accomplish great things as God's people demonstrate Christ to those around them." Word and deed. It may have been new to Dr. Graham, but it's come straight out of the pages of Scripture. Because what Jesus Christ is doing to that ragtag band of disciples at this point in time is saying, get busy. I am the crucified, resurrected, ascended Lord. Do not trifle. There is work to be done. There is a mission that he is calling his apostles and us to. It is not simply, Jesus died on the cross, he raised from the dead, he's at the right hand of the Father, I'm so glad I'm saved, I'm so glad I'm not on the Titanic, and I'm just waiting for Jesus to return. He has a mission. He has a mission. And the question that we have to ask and answer before ourselves is, how in the world, in light of everything that's gone on, and most likely will go on in your life, in my life, and in our nation, how will we move with great intention and confidence being on mission with Christ in the midst of what is going to be perceived surely as a great, great chaos? Where do we find the confidence to run into the fire knowing that Christ will see us through? How do we do that? Well, let's just start, look at verse 3. After his suffering, so Jesus is saying, don't forget the cross. Don't forget that I bore your sin. I bore the wrath of God. I justified before you. I satisfied the divine wrath of God and justice by my suffering. He presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. Quick question. This past week, did you live as if Jesus was alive or dead? Did you live as if he loved you or he hated you? I was watching an ESPN special last night. I can't remember the guy's name. Baseball player. Tried to commit suicide a couple years ago. David played for the Arizona. One night, he was by himself. He was locked down in COVID. And he finally decided he could not live any longer. And he took a 9mm and put it to his head and pulled the trigger. Something happened that it hit his eye, but it didn't kill him. And he woke up the next morning, and he couldn't believe that he was still alive. And he had a decision to make. He said, I was either going to put another bullet to my head, or I'm going to call 911. Now, this is a good-looking kid. This is a young, athletic, Hispanic kid that is Puerto Rican, that has made it to the big leagues. And he decides to call 911. He does. The police break the door down. He has slept in dried pool of blood. He is still alive. He only has one eye. And when those police officers and those SWAT guys blew in, they secured the area, made sure he didn't have another gun, and then one of the police officers kneeled down and said, what happened? He said, I tried to kill myself with a gun. The police officer said, why did you do that? And he said, because I hate myself. The gospel speaks to our self-hatred. It speaks to our self. It speaks to why we need not cut ourselves and hurt ourselves and speak to ourselves in ways that are less than gospel redeemed children of the Lord. Jesus comes and simply says in verse 3, I suffered. I have taken the sin away from you. You are loved. Live loved. That's the... Let's pray and go home. Just live love this week. Act like Jesus really loves you. Act like the Lord really loves you this week. I'll pray for you. You pray for me because I know it's a battle. He presented himself to them with many convincing proofs. Why? He's talking to his disciples. Many convincing proofs. They walked with him for 40 days. They were with the resurrecting Jesus. And he's teaching them all this stuff. And he gets them here and with more convincing proofs. Why? Because they're doubters. Because they struggle with unbelief. They walked with him for 40 days after he rose from the dead. And Jesus still is trying to convince him, I am alive. I died for your sins. You are loved. You are precious in my sight. The struggle with unbelief. He appeared to them over those 40 days and spoke to them about the kingdom of God. What is this? How do we do this? How do we do this confidence mission working out? It's you got to be willing to prepare for the mission. This is preparation, instruction. Jesus is teaching them. We need to be taught. We need to study. We need the word of God in our head and in our heart. We need to be after it. If Jesus instructed these folks over these 40 days and 40 nights, then we know that we need to remain teachable as well. Isn't it interesting, the commentary has pointed out, that Jesus instructed them before he poured out the Holy Spirit upon them. I wonder if they were complaining to him. Well, Lord, you haven't given us the promised Spirit yet. You know, you can't expect much from us. Yeah, isn't it just like us? You just haven't given me enough, Lord. Right? No, I've given you my word. I've given you instruction here to pursue that, to remain teachable. And then secondly, when he finally gets to verse 8, he says, and by the way, you're going to have to learn to trust the power. The power. This is the verse that actually is the theme of the whole book of Acts. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Ouch. Ouch. Lord, we pray for our children. We love our children. Power for our children. Power, yeah. You're going to receive power. That's a promise, by the way. That's not a conditional statement. That's not a hope. It's not a wish. That is a declaration. You will receive power. You need to wait, but you'll receive power. Training and instruction, an ever-growing trust in his Spirit, because, as one commentator said, the Spirit is the fire, the Word of God is the firewood. Our confession says that the Holy Spirit works by and with the Word of God. People say, I want to experience more of the Holy Spirit. I only got one thing for you. Read this. The Spirit of God works by and through and with the Word of God, which is tremendous because we have it. He's given us a great gift. Last thing, how to prepare. This is good news for some, but not for all. It only happens in the context of Christian community. Some of us are drawn because we're outwardly facing and we're extroverts. Some of us are introverts. We are not drawn towards crowds or other people, and both of us have problems that we have to get over somehow. It only happens in the context of Christian community. Look how many times it happens. Look at verse 4. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, it actually started in verse 3, after his suffering, he presented himself to them. Jesus, again, moving towards his people, moving towards his disciples. He met with them, verse 3, he appeared to them, verse 4, he was with them. This is his close fellowship. Some of your translations don't use the word he was eating with them. It said he came to them. So let's be fair to the interpreters. Let's be fair to those that are translating. I think the NIV got it right here, that actually it is they. And while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. He's supping with them. He is communing with them. He's being with them. To be part of a Christian community is absolutely critical to be able to be on mission with Christ in the midst of chaos. You can't do it by yourself. It's just not possible. What does that look like? Back in 1542, Martin Luther and Katie married. They had 7 children. And their oldest son, Hans, had just gone off to Wittenberg to study. And the next sibling down was his sister. They were very close, and she became very ill. Her name was Magdalena. And so Luther wrote to Hans, her older brother and his son, over to the university and said, "My daughter Magdalena is nearing her end and will soon go to her true father in heaven unless he sees fit to spare her. She longs to see her brother one more time, and I long for him to see her. They were very close, so I am sending a carriage for him in the hope that the sight of him will revive her." It didn't. Hans got home. He did get to see his sister just before she died. And after that, Luther writes this, the commentator said, "It grieved Luther that in spite of all the blessings he had received from God, listen, he found himself unable in this situation to give thanks." Do you know what that is? That's grief. That's sorrow that overtakes your mind in ways that you never thought was possible. Martin Luther, arguably the father of the Protestant Reformation, could not pray at the death of his daughter. Do you condemn him? Do you criticize him? Listen to what happened. On September 20th, 1542, after she had passed, Martin Luther wrote a quick note to a dear friend. The epitaph on his little daughter's gravesite was this: "Here I, Magdalena, Dr. Luther's little maid, resting with the saints, sleep in my narrow bed. I was a child of death, for I was born in sin, but I am now alive, redeemed, Lord Christ, by the blood you shed for me." And with that, he writes his friend, Justice Jonas, and says this: "My dear brother, I expect that you have heard about the death of my beloved daughter, Magdalena, that she has been born again into Christ's everlasting kingdom in heaven. Although my wife and I ought to rejoice because of her happy ending, yet such is the strength of my natural affections that we cannot even think without sobbing and groans with tears that tear our heart apart. The memory of her face," this is killing me, "the memory of her face, her words, her expressions in life and in death, everything about our most obedient and loving daughter lingers in my heart, so that even the death of Christ," and what are all deaths compared to his? "Even the death of Christ is almost powerless to lift our minds above our loss. So, my dear brother," this is when you trust. This is when you know you trust your brothers and sisters in Christ. "So would you please, my dear brother, give thanks to God in our stead, for we cannot do it at this time, and we want him to be thanked and praised by someone. Gratefully, your brother, Martin Luther." Honesty in the midst of great gravity and personal loss inside the community goes so deep that you can begin to trust one another with such things that you know in a regular gathering you would be condemned for. "You can't pray after you buried your daughter? What kind of Christian are you? Do you have no faith? Do you not know the Word of God? Do you not access the promises of God?" Rather, in the fellowship of brothers and sisters, we plead and beg for one another and pray for each other in ways that we may not even be able to get off our own lips because of the circumstances we are in. You think this is going to be an easy year coming? I got to tell you something. As I'm watching everything across the fruited plain in our denomination, our congregations are still at rivaling with one another over political issues. It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse financially. You don't know this because you're not the pastor, But right here this morning, just if you would just look around, I got to tell you, there are people that just lost their jobs in high places, good jobs, beneficial jobs, serving jobs. And there are some of us that for some reason have benefited during this time. What kind of dynamic do you think that creates in the body of Christ? It is only in the community. You're going to have to fight for this. That's what Jesus is saying. You're going to have to fight for this. This doesn't come naturally. This pulling them together. This Martin Luther sharing each other, the deepest, darkest time. Pray for me. You're going to have to fight for this. It's not automatic, but it's worth it. In the context of Christian community, we got to move on. What's the second thing? Okay, so I got to be prepared. I got to be willing to be instructed. I got to be listening to Christ. Got to be feeding my soul. Got to be gathering together. What else do you have to do? We got to figure out how to identify and remove the barriers. I mean, just look at, it's so easy to hit these guys hard, really, the disciples. But just look at a few things. Number one, what things did they have wrong? Well, number one, they had a wrong view of the Savior. Verse 3, many proofs, hey, I really am alive. They didn't believe him. They thought they were seeing a phantom. I mean, they were still thinking that he was dead. Jesus is alive. And we're going to talk in just a minute about his ascension. So, he's alive. Number two, he reigns. This is the most explicit passage about the ascension of Christ. And we see it in verse 9. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. So this is the ascending to power that the New Testament kind of hinted at, said a little couple times, and finally, before their very eyes, there he is taken up, bodily form. Why would Jesus do that in front of them? Because he was dead, because he was resurrected. They need to know that his promise is that he would be ruling and reigning someday at the very right hand of God the Father Almighty, watching over you every moment, pleading, praying for us, interceding for us. He is the crucified, resurrected, and ascended Lord of glory who loves you and is at work in you and through you and in spite of you. A right understanding of who Christ is. They didn't really understand his work. He reigns. Yes, he's alive, but he's saying, and I'm working. I mean, all through, he comes to them, he pleads with them, he defends himself to them, he commands them, he gathers them, he feeds them, and promises that he's going to empower them to do the work. Now, they got to be sitting around at some point in time and just go, if Jesus does just half of what he promised, we'll be all right. He's at work. Why do you struggle with that? We struggle with that because a lot of times we cannot make sense of his work. We can't make it make sense for us. It's one of the great struggles of all Christians of all times. I laugh at times. I've told you all about this event in my life that I look back on after I became a Christian and said, so that's what God is doing. So when the air went out of the basketball in your college and I stopped playing ball my sophomore year, I started to climb and do whitewater canoeing, kayaking, found a great friend in Tom Zartman. And so he started to teach me the ropes, how to climb, knots, ropes, positions. I mean, just how to get off the air and hang on the side of a cliff. I don't know why I was doing that. Explains a lot of things about my children, though. Unfortunately, Tom, that second summer, got a girlfriend, and so I was bumped down the ladder. I was no longer number two. I was number three. So one weekend, we were going climbing, going out to Chickie's Rocks. We're along the Susquehanna River. We're going to go hang off the cliffs, and he said, hey, I'm bringing Sherry. Oh. So he brings Sherry, and so we're doing a piece that's got an overhang, and it's very difficult because it's about a three and a half or four-foot layback, so you're standing there about 125 feet off the ground. And Tom's got the rope up top. It's a top rope. And you got to lean way back out here and reach this thing. It's very difficult. So I was down there just kind of watching and encouraging Sherry. And she gets to that place. I was not a Christian at the time, but if I was, I would have repented because I was hoping that she'd fall. I've never gotten over that crux move. I'm just, look, I'll tell you the truth. I've never been able to get that particular boulder problem and get over that. So sure enough, she gets up underneath it, and she's talking with Tom, and she's trying to, you know, get some courage, and he starts telling her what to do. And, you know, all of a sudden, she looks like an eight-legged spider, and she moves back and then around and over that thing and up to the top and gives Tom a big kiss. And I'm down here kicking the dirt and crying in my milk because I have no idea how she did it. So at dinner that night, after Sherry went home, I said to him, I've been working on that thing for months. Eight or nine months I've been trying to get that layback. I haven't been able to go. I can't believe she got it. How did she do it? To which he said, I know how she did it. Tell me. I cinched the rope around my waist, and I pulled her over. No. She looked like she climbed over it. I know. I pulled her over it. You keep climbing because I'm pulling, says the Lord God Almighty. You keep climbing even though you don't even feel like you can lift a finger to face tomorrow because I am still pulling. But I'm so tired. I know you're tired, but I'm pulling. We are on mission. Keep going. I'm discouraged. Of course you're discouraged, but I'm pulling. In my deepest, darkest times, what I most need to hear is, he is still working. He is still working. You're still on mission. But I'm in the pit. I'm unemployed. I'm not where I should be spiritually. My marriage is a mess. My kids are a mess. I lost my job. I'm a mess. Keep climbing. Because God's still pulling. Still working. Still working. That's what they needed to hear. Wrong understanding of himself, his reign, but also of his work. I am still working. They still had a greater problem. That's their misunderstanding of the kingdom. Look at verse 6. Then they gathered around him and asked him, and you can almost hear through the Greek the disciples kind of sheepishly asking this question. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? What are they asking for? They want a nation state. They want a political kingdom. They do not want a spiritual kingdom. They want a temporal kingdom. They don't want an eternal kingdom. They want an ethnic, mono-ethnic kingdom, while the kingdom that Jesus is coming and bringing in is universal. Not only is it universal, and by the way, do we need to go over those? We don't need to go over those. Okay. We know our struggles in the political arena. We got to get over it. Yeah. That is not a reason to divide with a Christian brother or sister. It is not legit in the sight of God. If we can't look beyond our political commitments and claim Jesus first, you need to come see me. I got a lot of openings this week. I'd be happy to talk with you. I'm a nice guy. I'll be nice. But what we see in verse 8, and what I think Jesus is trying to just drum into them, what one commentator phrased as, this widening of God's mercy and this welcoming of God's church. This widening. Those of you grew up in a church, you know this in verse 8. But you will receive power. That's an unconditional promise. Unconditional promise. What are you doing with the power of Christ in your life right now? You got it. You have it. That's an unconditional promise. No conditions. We got the power. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses, again, another declaration. You will be my witnesses is not a conditional phrase in the Greek. It's not conditional. You are being a witness for Jesus right now. Maybe good, maybe bad, maybe progressing, maybe not. It doesn't matter. You are a witness of Christ if you're a Christian. And then here we go. In all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So we got this Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. Okay, so who is Jesus saying they need to first prioritize in telling them about the gospel of Jesus Christ? Jerusalem, the Jews. Well, that's going to be a fun escapade, right? You need to go back in and stay here and tell all the Jews that I really am the risen Messiah and I'm the Son of God. And by the way, I'm the great I am. What do you think they were thinking? What's next, Jesus? We'd rather move on, right? Conflict, rejection. Well, then let's go on to Jerusalem, Judea. So this is where the, This is where the Jews who began to leave Jerusalem because they were not as orthodox, for lack of a better term, as those committed Jews that lived in Jerusalem. So now we've got those that are kind of half compromised. We go from there, Jerusalem, Judea, to Samaria. Who's there? Half-breeds. These are the liberal Jews who have left and inbred and married non-Jewish people. That's why you have so striking when Jesus met the Samaritan woman at the well. Double no-no. She's a Samaritan, she's unclean, and she's a woman. She's property. Jesus validates her and invites her into the kingdom. Jerusalem, Judea, half-breeds in Samaria, and to the other ends of the world. In the Jewish mind, there was only two types of people. Jewish people and everybody else. And Jesus says, this thing, this gospel has been widening since the book of Genesis 15. Abraham, remember? The father of all nations, greater than the sand on the seashore, right? This widening, and then this idea of a welcoming community as well, as he continues to work with them, bringing them in and giving them a vision for being, reflecting the widening of God's mercy through his covenant promises, and be a welcoming people. I'm not sure why I picked it up this past week, but I reread part of, yes I did. Did I bring it? Rosaria Butterfield. Do you remember her? She was the Syracuse English teacher. She was a outspoken lesbian, had been most of her adult life. She was angry by her own admission. She eschewed Christians because of the way they treated her. She was very prolific, very well respected in her field. And the Lord started kind of moving in a way in her life that she met a man who was a pastor who actually loved her and began to try and help her along with his wife to help her find new life in Christ. Because she was so prominent in the gay and lesbian community, she took a lot of heat, but she stayed with it. And at one point in time, she had gone to church, and she took one of her friends, who actually was a drag queen, to church. And she said, you know, it kind of blew the church up for a while, but it was a test for me to see if these people who are loving on me as a self-professed, prolific, scholarly English professor at Syracuse, if they would love my friends as well. Listen to what she said on page 23. The teaching, the prayers, and the friendships the Lord has given to me through the body of Christ has blessed me richly. I am very grateful that the Lord brought me to a church that was as strong on teaching as it was on compassion. So I just threw down. If it's really Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, then who will not be welcomed within our church? Who? We have great news for the world, and we can't let anything get in the way. That's what Jesus is telling his disciples. Samaritans. I don't even know. You know, we've had a couple. ISIS, right? We've used ISIS. We've used to the other ends of the world. It's a great challenge. We'll need each other, and we'll need to encourage each other as we go. I got to be done here. Okay, so what do we got? We've got this instruction. We're actually in preparation mode, constantly living and learning from each other, from the Word of God, drawing near to each other, small group Bible studies, worship, Sunday school. It's going to get, we're looking at the fall, about getting things rejuvenated here, starting with VBS here. We want to tell the kids about Christ, so we're getting there. We're getting there. Identify the barriers. They seem insurmountable unless you got Jesus on your side. He's with us. And then we finally got this idea of this proclamation. And you got to tell people about me. What should I tell them? That I'm a suffering Savior. that I'm a forgiving Savior, but on that cross, I did everything that I said I would do and more. That I have taken your sins and you can be forgiven. Secondly, I'm resurrected. I have overcome your deepest, darkest enemy, death itself. And thirdly, I'm the ascended one. Verse 11, when he ascended into heaven, this is great. They were looking intently into the sky. Commentators had a heyday with this. You know, stargazing, you know. Is that Orion? Big Dipper, Little Dipper. I don't know. I can't see anything during the day. Oh my word. Staring into the sky. I can only imagine what they were thinking. I don't know. But as they were looking intently into the sky, as Jesus was going, two men spoke to them, something like, wake up. This same Jesus who came, he is going to come back just as he left, bodily form. People, you know, my kids used to always ask us, Dad, how's that going to happen? I mean, Jesus is coming back just as he left in bodily form, and every eye is going to see him. Man, that's got to be some big, jumbotron that we're going to... I said, you know, buddy, I don't know how that's going to happen, but he's coming back the same way you saw him go into heaven. He is coming back for us. Not stargazing, not wondering what's going on, but a real certain confidence that this is finally going to happen. At some point in time, only the Father knows, everything wrong is going to be made right. Everything broken is going to be healed. And everything dead is going to come alive. Peter Wagner tells of a young lady that used to be in his church, Kansas. She grew up in a church. She was dutiful. She was obedient. Loved the Lord. She went to college in the Midwest. She took a speech communications class her first semester there, and in it, they all had to give a persuasive speech. And two students per class gave it, and when her time came, it was the last class because her name was at the end of the alphabet. And there was a girl before her that went. And for that girl's speech, they went outside. And this girl brought a trash can with her and a Bible. And she got over there and she read a portion of scripture from the Old Testament. If one picks up a stick on the Sabbath, they shall be stoned. And that girl ripped that page out of the Bible and said, who wants to believe in a God like this? And she lit it with her lighter and threw it in that metal trash can. She looked at the law, Exodus 20. You shall worship the Lord your God only. She ripped it out. Who wants to worship a megalomaniac who demands your worship? Lit it on fire, threw it in a trash can. She got to the place where God calls his people in Exodus to plunder the Egyptians. Take their loot, take it with you. She read it, tore it out, and said, who wants to believe in a God like this? She lit it, burned it, put it in the pail. That was the end. We're back inside. Pastor Peter Wagner's gal, the little girl that grew up through the church, she got up there and she had a guitar. And she just sang a few stanzas of that old praise song we used to sing, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us that we should be called children of God. She was shaking in her boots. Slight Midwestern little girl got up there with a little guitar. Behold, what matter of love the Father has given unto us that we should be called children of God. And this is what we are. She steps down. Everybody leaves. And as the kids leave the classroom, they sneer and some spit at little Susie over here. There was one other student left in that classroom by herself. And that's the girl who burned the Bible. And she walked up to little Susie and said, it's clear to me that you really know the one at which you sang, and I wondered if you would tell me about him. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Holy Trinity, sealed your life as at work in and through you and in spite of you and is in work in this world. And he says, go. We are on mission with a great Savior a wonderful spirit that goes before us and in us, who tells us even in our darkest moments, I am still at work in you, in your church, in your marriage, and in my world. Take heart. He's overcome the world. For the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Pray with me. Father, how we so long to have a deeper trust, abiding love, rest. And to know in an experiential way that you are with us, leading, guiding us into mission. We are not here for ourselves, and our church is not here for ourselves, for those who are yet to come. Give us a bigger vision of you. Help us to cling more tightly to your promises, for you have given us your spirit and its power. Help us to access it, help us to love it, and help us to relish in it, bringing you honor and glory and seeing you using us, this little tiny church, us, advancing the kingdom of grace, destroying the kingdom of darkness, and praising you along the way. Give us that great gift, we pray. We love you and we thank you for it. Amen.
Please stand as we sing Lead On, O King Eternal.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.